Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, October 2nd, 2016. This is the 20th Sunday after Pentecost. This is also Communion Sunday. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio.
St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is Sunday, October 2nd, 2016, 20th Sunday after Pentecost. We have a hymn today written by Mary Lathbury. It's a Methodist hymn. It was written in 1877 to welcome Ulysses S. Grant to the Lake Chautauqua Sunday School. And this lady was the daughter of a Methodist minister.
Thank you.
and also with you. Doing the readings today.
Good morning. The first reading is from Habakkuk. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous. Therefore judgment comes forth early. I will stand at my watch post and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitroff will be doing the psalm.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the
for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of pride, of love, and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
John Pollock is preparing to read the gospel. It's from Luke and it's on faith. So listen carefully to the words of Jesus, the gospel being read by our pastor, Pastor John Pollock.
Countries that have had natural involved in conflicts where there's refugees and resettlement. And so we thank the ladies for their work. Also, they invite anyone who is interested in quilting to join them. They quilt all Wednesday mornings. For more information, you can ask Helen Wallace or maybe Minnesota Fox. Also, we have sign-up sheets for Yuletide. You'll find them on the bench right outside of the doors of the sanctuary. There are the bench in the narthex portion. Also, they're in the atrium, on the table in the atrium. Also, Charlene has a large sign-up sheet on her desk that you may recall or come in and sign up to help with Yuletide Festival Thursday, Friday, or Saturday. And the last announcement is a reminder that Ohio Valley has said we may use their parking lot right next to the church. I parked there this morning. The gate is open, so you just walk out the sidewalk and come in the fire entrance. So if you would like to park your car in their fenced-in parking lot on Sunday mornings, feel free to do so. Now I ask that you give your attention to our thank you. Bible studies, whether at the church or in the neighborhood. They may become part of a prayer group. They may make an effort to read the Bible on their own every day, several times a day. They may also join some activities that are not associated with the national church or the local church, groups where they can go on retreats and so forth, hoping that they will build up their faith. And oftentimes, because they do not think their faith is very strong, or that the size of it is not very great, they will oftentimes also step back from volunteering to do things when asked, or will run from a call from Jesus or the Holy Spirit to do something in the church because they think their faith just isn't up to it. Well, this morning in the 17th chapter of the Gospel of St. Luke, as the chapter opens up, Jesus is speaking to his disciples about temptation and forgiveness. And he talks about how if you tempt somebody to fall away from the faith, or you tempt somebody to abandon their faith, that it would be better that a millstone be tied around your neck and you're thrown into the bottom of the sea. This then brings him to the topic of forgiveness. And he explains to the disciples how if someone does something to you and they do not repent, then you should forgive them. But if they repent, then you must forgive them. And he says, even if seven times a day a person does something and they repent, you are to forgive them. So the apostles hear this, and they look at themselves and they think, how in the world can we fulfill such a command of our master? We want to be like you, master, but how in the world can we, with the little faith we have, do what you're asking? So that brings us to our sermon text today, where we read in verse 5, the apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. And the Lord said, if you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey. So, from this answer of Jesus, we learn three important aspects or lessons about faith. The first is the fact of faith, that faith is a reality. The disciples realize it. That's why they ask for their faith to be increased. Everyone in the world has faith in something, even the atheists. The atheist says, well, they don't believe in God. But they believe in something. Whatever their ultimate concern is, that is their God. Whether it's their job, whether it's a profession, whether it's having more and more material things, more and more money, whether it's having prestige, whether it's having popularity or publicity, whatever it is, that's their God. So everybody has faith. Everyone has faith in things besides God. You have faith in your doctors when you go to the doctor. You have faith in your teachers. You have faith in the medicine that you are prescribed to take. You have faith in, or usually, or hopefully, faith in the food you prepare, that it's going to be in a good meal. You have faith in the local gas station that when you go and pull up and you open up your gas tank and you take that hose down from the tank and put it in your car, it's going to actually put gasoline in your car and not something else. So there's all kinds of ways of having faith. But what is important is the faith in God. The faith to be able to do that which God wants us to do. And so the disciples say, increase our faith. The word increase means to add to something that's already present. It means to join two things together and make them stronger. It means to give you more of something you have, or it means to produce further what you have. So the disciples are saying, Lord, add to our faith, or join your faith to ours. Give us more faith. Enable us to produce more through this greater faith. And so for them, the whole thing is their amount of faith. But the reality is, as long as you have faith, that is what is important. It doesn't matter how big it is. What is important is that you have it. And when you have it, you are to act on it. And in acting on your faith, you're to look to the Lord for that faith and obey Him, trust Him, and accept Him as your Lord and Savior. That is faith. It doesn't matter, again, how large it is. The fact is that you have faith. What is important is that it is a genuine faith. That it is a faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. That you're not looking at Jesus as simply another great prophet in a long line of prophets. You're not looking at Jesus as another great moral teacher and a great line of moral teachers throughout history. That you're not looking at Jesus as another great philosopher in that long line of philosophers that we've had. That Jesus is a revolutionary or a reformer. That is not genuine faith. Genuine faith is believing that Jesus Christ, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, buried, on the third day rose, and He ascended into heaven. That is genuine faith. And as long as you have it, no matter how little it is, no matter how large it is, that's what's important. A little diamond has ever been a diamond just as a big diamond is. A drop of rain has ever been water as a great sea. And a little faith is ever been as much faith as a strong faith. And whether it's a little faith or a strong faith, it can save a sinner and give them salvation. So you recognize the fact of faith. Second lesson Jesus is teaching is about the quantity. If you have faith like a grain of mustard seed. Now, a grain of mustard seed is supposed to be one of the smallest things there is. It's supposed to be so tiny that it's hard to see. Mm-hmm. And he's saying if your faith is just that big, you'll be able to do things. The word life means a manner or way of something, or to do something in that manner. So Jesus is saying if your faith is in the manner of a mustard seed, or in the way of a mustard seed, you can do great things. So we see it's not the quantity of your faith. It's the genuineness of your faith. You have faith. That is what is important. As a brother and sister in Jesus Christ, one thing you want to never say are the words, my faith is too weak. Never want to say that as a follower of Jesus Christ. Because what happens when you say that is that you're putting the emphasis on yourself instead of upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Just like salvation is a gift and we can do nothing to earn salvation, we accept it through faith. And the grace as a gift from God. Faith is a gift. St. Paul tells us faith comes from hearing from the Word of God. Or as the explanation to the third article of the Creed, the article on the Holy Spirit says, the Holy Spirit calls us to the gospel. See that? Faith comes from hearing. The Holy Spirit calls us to the gospel, enlightens us with its gifts, sanctifies and keeps us in the true faith. So again, just like salvation, faith is an act of God through Jesus Christ. That's where it all comes from. We receive it. We hear the Word of God. The Holy Spirit calls us through that Word of God, gives us gifts, and the it is not for us to sit back and moan and groan about the quantity of our faith. We're not to feel inferior. We are not to fear or to feel less important because so-and-so over here seems to have a stronger faith than I do, or a larger faith than I do. It's not a contest. I'm sure you know people, as I have throughout your life in the church, that kind of like to brag about themselves and talk about how great their faith is, and they always spout off Bible verses to you and always tell you all the wonderful things they've done. But remember, Jesus talked about those who blow their own horn, that they've already received their reward. It's not a contest. It's not a competition. We are given the amount of faith we need. Yes, we pray for increase in faith. But one thing more important than praying for increase in faith is what the man who came to Jesus to have him heal his son said when Jesus said to him to believe. He said, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." So instead of praying, he said, "Don't make my faith larger," we should be saying, "Lord, help me in those times of unbelief or doubt." The quantity doesn't matter. You have faith, no matter what size, it can cause wonderful things to happen. So we put our trust in Jesus. We look to Jesus for our faith, not to ourselves. And we don't worry about the quantity. Which brings us in to the third lesson Jesus is teaching us, which is the power of faith. Even little faith, as small as a mustard seed, has the power to do great things. If you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, "Be uprooted and planted in the sea," and it would obey you. Obey. The word means to listen to give heed to be obedient, to conform to a command. So Jesus is saying that if your faith is just that of a mustard seed, that mulberry tree would conform to your command. It would listen to you. It would give heed to what you said. But what he's saying as far as our life of faith is that no matter how small our faith is, if we have faith, we then can proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, and people will listen to us. They'll give heed to us. They'll be obedient to the gospel. They'll conform to the gospel of Jesus Christ as we share it with them. So that goes back to that saying that I said, never say, "My faith is too weak." Jesus comes to you to share the good news with somebody. Don't say, "My faith is too weak." Because if Jesus is calling you to share your faith with someone, he's giving you the faith to share that gospel. And he will guide the words that you say so that you say what is needed. To share with that person the good news of the gospel so the Holy Spirit can call them to the gospel. And enlighten them with his gifts. And sanctify and keep them in the true faith. And so there is power in the gospel. There is power in faith. And it doesn't matter the size. A little faith is a lot. A little faith is better than no faith. And we don't know how our faith will expand. We don't know how our faith will grow. We have no idea what God wants us. We have no idea where God might lead us from day to day. The important thing is to have that faith. It's just like somehow in America, and I think where it comes from. It comes from the old Calvinistic Puritans. But in this country, we've developed this idea where you can't question God. I remember reading a biography about someone who talked about how he lost his son. A tragic construction accident. He said, "But you can't question God." Well, evidently, that person's never written the book of Psalms or the book. Job. Because there's an awful lot of question about Psalms and in the book of Job. And on that first Good Friday, on that hill outside the walls of Jerusalem, our Lord Jesus Christ himself said, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" We can question God, but we don't lose faith. We question God in faith, not in doubt, not in unbelief. So you can question God, but the important thing is just to always have faith. No matter how little it is, because a little is a lot. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Hear our prayer.
God of faithfulness
encircle in your loving kindness. We lift up to you all in need. Hear our prayers on behalf of others and sustain us as we await the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Time for our offering. Our ushers are Janet Hogue and Sharon Leach. Worship assistant today is Harvey Baker. Reader was Connie Singleton. Communion assistant will be Sally Baker. We had a youth event scheduled for today, roller skating and pizza, but it's been postponed until the first Sunday in November. Our youth leaders are Gary and Jan Dabe. You will meet at St. John's parking lot, Lowry Avenue, at around 2 o'clock, the first Sunday in November. We have 10 or 12 people who will be here going skating, and pizza will be covered. Roller skating and pizza at USA Skating Center across from our mall. There will be more announcements, will be awaited in the bulletin for that. We're going to have a youth event every month now. The first Sunday, we're going to have roller skating, the first Sunday in November, and then ice skating after that. Meet Gary and Jan Dabe. They will have some transportation, but if you would need to provide some of your own transportation. The transportation to the skating rink is easy because we're right down the street. We invite the ladies of the church to attend the BNPW at Los Mariachis Restaurant this coming Tuesday at 5:30 p.m. Today we have Holy Communion. Sunday school was at 9:15, and we have the midweek service will be at 6:30. You can receive Holy Communion at that time. Receive the offering now. We invite you to come to St. John's Lutheran Church. Be with us. 8 o'clock service, 10:30 service, Sunday school, youth group, first Sunday in every month, BNPW. We invite you to come join the quilting group. We give quilts to the poor. So come and call the church office, join the quilting group, and also serve to people who are in need. The Rainbow Table every week, and we give out food during the week and articles to the needy. We serve 8,000 people who are needy every month. So come and join us and help us as we are increasing our faith as the size of a mustard seed, and we're able to feed the world.
Choirs of angels and the church on earth and the and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take
me, this is my body given for you.
Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant, my blood shed to you for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering therefore his sanctuary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to the Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we ought. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus called us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
We have just received the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who suffered, bled, and died for us. And he will be with us forever. He has given us eternal life. Come and worship with us, 8 o'clock, 10:30. Harden not your hearts to the voice of God, to the sacrifice that Jesus has made for us. Düsseldorf, Germany, Behold the Man. On our way rejoicing, Frances Havergill was only 17. She was from England. She saw this art in Germany and was inspired by it. Became a Moravian. Count Düsseldorf, these people came to the United States and helped to Christianize the Indians. On our way rejoicing. Watching our service on YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this service. We will have a Christian school in January. We need an administrator. We've had a Christian school here for 50 to 60 years, and we're working on getting it started again. call our school office. We're interested in helping with this church school. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you and keep this day in all your ways, all your days. We'll pray for you. Continue to pray for our ministry. Our flowers today, one of the flower vases is given by Donna Peer in honor of Fred Peer, who is deceased. We have live flowers here every Sunday, and we're happy to have this from our Creator God. We're happy to have you worship with us. We want you to admire the quilts that have been made by the ladies here at the church. We meet every week to quilt and give these quilts away to the people who are cold and need them. Rachel from Grace Works will be having a free workshop here at church. Grace Works is to regain control of your finances. We have an office here at St. John's. If you're having trouble with your finances, if you're having problems any kind, you need help from us. We would be happy to have you come anytime. Donna Pure gave flowers in loving memory of her husband Fred, Don and Louise Kreitz, Miriam Louise's dad, Joe Parmesino Sr.'s birthday. So it's Joe Parmesino's birthday, and in memory of Fred Pier, we have the flowers today. Happy to have you worship with us anytime. 10:30 service, 8 o'clock service, every Sunday. Harden not your heart. Listen to God as He is speaking to you, and receive Jesus Christ, and receive the Holy Spirit, and receive eternal life.